Welcome everyone to the video. The Holy Spirit has just said, keep chatting. So I'll just keep chatting. There's some profound situation going on. I had a dream last night, early this morning, that was so extraordinary, I can't even begin to explain it. I really can't even begin to explain it. Out of that came the prayer, I abide with the light. I live as the light. I have no needs. And you can add, I am the light. I abide with the light. I live as the light. I am the light. I have no needs. But the dream, I cannot explain it. It was so profound. Just some complete turnaround that just, you can't even hardly conceptualize the turnaround. Not traditionally, not an ordinary conceptualization, that is for sure. So I will keep chatting here, and maybe there are a few that this is going to help, possibly, or maybe it's just helping me out get through a time of tremendous pressure here, for sure, but also an emergence. Surrender to the light. What is surrendering? Light, surrender to light. Keep this in mind, that what we see here as the world is actually just is light superimposing a play upon itself, so that we, the viewers of this play, can have the presumption that we're watching, we're experiencing, observing, experiencing, witnessing, watching a different realm, something different than reality. This is what it's all about. This is what we're doing. We as spirit ask light. Light, we want to have a separate reality. And so light obliged and said, okay. So light is superimposing upon light. This play is a play upon light, a superimposition upon light, light upon light, that gives the appearance that it's not the light anymore. This is a different realm, different than reality, a different light. And we are simply observing this, like watching a movie, and saying, wow, we really do have a separate kingdom. Look at this. That's all that it is. I mean, let's make it very simple and self-evident, and be just honest about the situation. And all of this birth and death and everything is just a superimposition on the light. We were never born. There's no birth. Actual birth taking place. It's just a play of light that's taking place. We're not being born. We're watching like watching a movie. There isn't any real birth. Nothing's ever been born. Nothing's ever been born. This is a movie. When you see stuff on a movie, or you say, oh, it's actually being born, or is it just a play of light? It's just a play of light. But it gives the appearance as if something other than light is happening. That it's not a play of light, that it's a play of flesh and form. Yeah, it seems different than reality to us. We think we're viewing something separate from reality, which is what we asked for in the first place. So ask and ye shall receive. That is what we asked for. This is what we've received. But when we get tired of it, what we say, okay, let me just set it down. Whoops, I have a continuity fear. I say, oh my gosh, what happened to my separate kingdom? Where'd it go? What do I do now? There's no separate kingdom. How do I function? You know, just all this freak out is there. You know, so we have to gradually melt the fear away. As we melt the fear away, everything becomes more self-evident. The whole situation becomes more and more self-evident. No need for sophistication, subtlety, complexity, anything like that. It's just putting on a play, a little play, light putting on a play as per our request. And we ask, make it seem like it's a new reality. And so it does seem like this is not reality, this is something else. Birth and death and lives and flesh and all this stuff, what is this? Actually, none of it's happening in reality. It's not happening as a separate reality at all. It's simply a light playing upon light, light superimposing upon light. So it seems like the light is not doing it, that there's some other force doing it. Not the light. The light is like hiding its activities as if it's not doing it. It's just some other force that is creating this play. And we think, ah, you see, I asked for a separate reality. Here it is. I have it now. It's just a presumption. It's just, it's a fantasy. or imagination. We're having this fantasy, you know. But so once we recognize this, then we surrender to the light. We say, light, the silly notion. I surrender the silly notion that there was ever any birth took place. There was never any birth. Nothing was ever born. How can it be born? The idea of being born is somehow it starts. There's a change that life starts somehow. Life starts. That light starts. A new light starts. Something is born. If it's all just the one light in a seamless way, yet appearing not to be so, it's still all just the one light. And so we can give up this fantasy, give up this delusion, and then light will show us that it really is all just the light. That's the vision of oneness. The vision of oneness shows us all of this is simply the play of the one light. There's never been a separate reality. Light is never separated from itself. There is no other force. There is no other light. There is no other force whatsoever. Light was just presenting this play to us. And it will show it so it's completely self-evident to us. Completely self-evident. Whereas for those who want to keep on believing that they have a separate kingdom, it won't be self-evident at all. And so their questions will be like all complex. Like they ask questions like that. You know, you can tell it reflects, you know, their desire to believe there's a separate reality. And their continuity fear, severe continuity fear, and this, the questions be all complex and all subtle. And they say, I don't see any self-evidency at all. Well, of course not, because their desire is to not see it. So it doesn't seem self-evident at all. And so they will try to conceptualize the clarity instead of actually allowing the self-evidency to arise. That's why you get all sorts of massive amounts of spiritual inquiry and techniques and everything. Is there's this ambivalence of, well, how can I have it both ways? How can I have it both ways? I'm afraid of the continuity fear. How can I make this new light seem like the old light, except still stay the new light? How can I make this new reality seem like the old reality, but still be the new reality? Or how can I adjust better to this new reality, this new light, which isn't the same as the old light? How can I manage to be happy in this new reality? You know, all these various questions. How can I resolve this all without it being self-evident? How can I? So of course there's going to be massive amounts of different types of spiritual teachings, for sure. And it's really, you know, a burden to have to just let it all melt away. It takes a while. It takes a while. That's why most the great teachers say, just decide you're going to give a lifetime effort to this, okay? And then just go for it. Go for broke. Try to do as fast as possible. But just say, you know, I'm not going to quit. I'm just going to use this whole lifetime, supposed lifetime, to recognize it, to recognize that there are no lifetimes. I was never born. I never created. There's no creation of all this birth and death. It's not a creation. It's a play of light. It's just a play of light I desire to see. It's not an actual creation. These aren't actual births and deaths. It's just the light is just putting on this play. And of course, we think in all these births and deaths means that I too, you know, the self, the spirit, it has been born also, like born into a new reality. Right? We're watching this play, and we're thinking, we're drawing a conclusion from it. The conclusion we want to draw from it is, hey, I must have separated from God. I must have been born into this new reality. And now I am the ruler of this new reality. We get this impression from all this stuff that we're, you know, that we're watching. This movie is like giving us this feeling that we're after, at least trying to. And so we're just chatting about this, realizing we could kind of look at it. very warm days here. It's like 91 today, staying. It's already still about 90. So don't struggle with trying to understand it. It's just like a chat, a very relaxed chat about these essential matters. And if you just allow the self-evidency to arise and just say, oh, okay. We don't have to be all freaked out by this. When we surrender the light, what we're really saying is, light, I no longer want you to pretend to not be light. Okay. And then that is what's going to bring about this enlightenment. Enlightenment is when we decide, we ask light, say, light, I've decided, it's my will, to no longer have light pretend to not be light, okay? And then somehow, the whole, all of this play is enlightened. We see, oh, it's all the light. It's just the light. It's the play of the light. That is nothing more than that. It's never been anything other than that. Then we realize, I was never born. I never took any births. All this was a play superimposed upon the light. So thinking that since I am the light, thinking that I was being born, going through these births and deaths and all this stuff, where it was only a play being superimposed upon the light. The light was actually not being born and not dying at all. But it certainly had a realistic appearance to it, didn't it? Absolutely. This is the genius of the light. So we have to forgive the light. What do we forgive? We forgive the light because it's only done what we asked it to do. And people report this marvelous experience of enlightenment, of where they realize, oh, it's always only been the one light all along, not the play of two different lights, not the yin and yang actually. The yin and yang actually is just the one light putting on a little play because we asked it to. So enlightenment, surrender, the silly notion that what we are could be born. How can light give birth to light? You see, the whole idea of birth is that there's something new coming, right? Something different, new that wasn't there before. How could light give birth to light? Light is always present. Omnipresent isness. How can omnipresent isness give birth to omnipresent isness, as it were, as a birth? It's not a birth, it's an extension or an extension of play within it, but it cannot actually give birth. Can't say, oh, I gave birth to light. Light can't say, I gave birth to light. Light is the light. Light is light. It cannot separate from itself and say, this is something that is now separate. This is a separate light that I gave birth to. It's not like that. So I, as the light, I was never born. I was never born. Then just get used to the statement, I was never born. I was never born. I've never been born. In fact, nothing has ever been born. These are all just appearances. Temporary appearances arising as a play. Like bubbles. But the bubbles are not actually separate. There isn't any separation. Birth implies a separation. There isn't any separation whatsoever. Zero. Zero. And yet there's this massive appearance of it, isn't there? So it is, you know, quite a shock to realize there's been zero separation. Now, But in the just looking at this, the chatting about it, looking at it, the fear begins to, fear melts away, it melts away more and more, it melts away. And every day you'd be surprised. Today you realize, hey, I'm not so afraid of that. And you realize that you used to be like super afraid of it. And you say, wow, that's incredible progress actually. So just surrender the notion that there's anything that needs to be surrendered, as it were. Everything is okay. Everything is perfect. The light is still perfect. The light didn't get transformed into something, into darkness. You know, now darkness also is a superimposition of light upon light. One moment. Okay. So it may be that this dream I had was this light surrendering to light experience. There was something like that. It was really unprecedented. I have a lot of dreams of profound shifts that seem to be very difficult to explain, and then later on the explanation sort of surfaces. I'm able to give some sort of clarification about it. This latest one was really quite something. It may have been the light surrendering to light. How do you explain that? You know, I mean, that's really profound. Light giving up the notion that it's not light. But of course, the notion was only a play based on the desire of spirit. Light is the servant of spirit, as it were. It's the glue that holds all experiencing together. And enables all experiencing, presents all experiencing. But spirit is the one that is saying, hey, this is what I want to experience. So light did not do this to itself. Light is simply responding to our desire. So really, it's simply enlightenment is light showing us that everything's okay with light. That we've just been watching this magical mystery tour of a show. And it was all just a fantasy. And the thing is that it only will come about when you're ready for it, when that's what you really want. It's not something that can be forced because it's your own desire. You ask the light, okay, all right, that's enough. Let's reassure me that light is light, that's all. Let me be reassured that light is light and not something else. And then making that request, then the light should present that experience to you. That's all. Now, this fantasy we're having has all sorts of storylines to keep us interested in it, as if something is happening. You know, something's happening. That the new light is in the process of revealing itself to us. So we get strung along. Of course, it strings us along. That's part of the deal. It has to string us along, because otherwise we would just say, this is just a fantasy. But we think that there's more and more being revealed. It's getting richer and richer, the whole experience. And yet it always leaves this feeling of dissatisfaction, doesn't it? Unfulfillment, fear, confusion, dissatisfaction, a feeling of I need to search more. I didn't quite get it. You know, it just always, you know, it's this incredible storyline of stringing us along. And so we think we're missing something. We're missing the fact that it's all a fantasy, light, a play of light upon light. It's not what we really want. We don't really want to spend this. We don't really want to be experiencing this. It seems like a story of death, you know, right? A story of vulnerability, a story of death. Light being vulnerable to light. This reinforces our belief that, hey, it's possible, you know. This is what happened to light. It died. Light died. And then something rose from the death of light. And it's just so melodramatic, isn't it? It's like a massive opera. Eventually you get really tired of that. And then you desire to say, okay, it's enough of that. And light, reassure me that you're fine, light is light. So you're asking the light to just show you, just to be the light. Don't try to deceive us anymore, just be the light. So of course, that surrendering to the light means you're willing to have that experience that you surrender the desire for light to appear to not be light. And so of course, you're going to experience something that is beyond the electromagnetic spectrum. Okay, for sure. Spiritual light, you get what they call it. It's just light that is not so extremely frozen and condensed. Which electromagnetism is like the most condensed, frozen state of light possible, actually. It's very, very extremely frozen and condensed. And so for light to reassure us, it starts out by showing us spiritual light, which just means it's beyond electromagnetic light. Light as electromagnetism. So it does, of course, it doesn't obey laws of electromagnetism. Of course not. It's omnipresent. It's everywhere. It doesn't matter day or night. It doesn't. The physics, electromagnetism, doesn't matter. Don't matter. And this is still the light that we see in enlightenment here. Is still, like I say, about stepped down about five times. It still transcends electromagnetism, but there are still electromagnetism is the most stepped down, frozen form of light in order to give us this appearance that it's not really light. And so there may be this enlightenment, and then later on we'll be reassured by even higher enlightenment. And the higher enlightenment was, it's less stepped down, the light, as it reassures us. It reassures us all the way back to the clear light. Absolutely, totally clear. And that experience, you cannot really even remain in this world very much very long if you were to abide in the absolute clear light, which is the way that God created light. You wouldn't be able to stay here. So we're not even interested and worried about that at all. We're just simply interested in the first enlightenment, actually. That's all that's required. Because once we break the spell of this fantasy of light not being light, then the rest is easy, because we realize, it's only a continuity problem I have. And I know that'll automatically evaporate. So we're interested in what's called enlightenment here, the first enlightenment, actually. Which just transcends the electromagnetic spectrum, electromagnetism, electromagnetic universe, transcends it, as it were. It says this is less frozen light, and to us, it will dispel this whole fantasy, the universe, electromagnetic universe, the fantasy of form and impermanency and all of this definition. And then we will not be fooled into thinking that we're somehow a form, a definition, an object in this universe. We'll realize, no, this is all a play of light. We will know this is all just a play of light the entire time. And so we will then feel total relief here. And people will say, wow, why are you so relieved? You know, it's amazing. And there's even greater relief to come, you know, later on in our return back to the absolutely clear light. But we don't need to, that automatically will follow in the right sequence. We don't need to be concerned about that. We're concerned here about this fantasy, because this one is the most, this is the one that is frozen, condensed most. It gives the most appearance of the light being something other than the light, you see. And once this is dispelled, then the rest is easy. The rest is easy. But we will not be immediately rocketed back to the clear light. No, absolutely not. No. There's no need. Light's in, or light knows that it's light. It doesn't need to prove anything. It's not under some time pressure. It's not saying, wow, I've got to get you back to the clear light. Otherwise, you know, I might turn into a pumpkin or something. No, not at all. Of course, in hearing all this, you say, wow, okay, this sounds right, but, you know, what about science and what about all this stuff? Well, they're just, you know, they're fascinated by this play, this overlay, light overlaying light, and they're trying to measure it and weigh it. And I think this is real. They're trying to make it real. You say, wow, we've got something real here. Let's label it. Let's name it. Let's name it. Let's measure it. Let's quantify it. You know, this is our reality. This is our new reality. We gotta let's get used to it. Let's make it home. Let's, you know, so of course they're not interested in what is self-evident, the self-evidency. In other words, not interested in the evidence that the light can present. All we have to do is ask the light to present the evidence, and it will present the evidence for us. They're interested in getting the evidence themselves. Saying no. This is real, and I'm going to get the evidence that I'm looking for here. What is that? So, of course, those who are not interested in self-evidency will not find it. Will not find it. It only comes from the light itself, being transcending this play. It doesn't come from our concepts, our naming. Doesn't come from measuring or quantifying equations and all the stuff that science does. So leave science out of it. Science doesn't have anything to do with it. Although some of the very abstract theoretical sciences are kind of touching on it, actually. The unmanifest, the manifest, the unmanifest. And I say, wow, well, you know, what is this? And but the way they're, you know, going at it is so non-self-evident in a lot of ways, and not really repentant, not really understanding the big picture. It is necessary to understand the big picture, how light has been stepped down so many times. And they're only thinking that, you know, they're just scratching the surface kind of thing. So don't waste time. Don't waste time worrying about that. It's all silly. They want to measure everything. Measure your body. You know, what happened here? You know, what is this thing? It's blind people asking questions about you know, how are you able to do this stuff while being blind? It's like the blind assume everyone is blind, and then they're really like puzzled, like how come this blind person is able to drive this car, you know, do all this stuff. He said, I wish I could do that. That's amazing. I want to figure out this, so let's do all these tests. And it's like that. Imagine a world where everyone was blind, and there was someone who had sight, and the one who had sight is able to do all the stuff, of course, the blind can't do. And the blind are like totally baffled and saying, we too want to learn how to do this. Can you teach us how to do this? And these courses say, well, just open your eyes. And they say, what are you talking about? I have no idea what you're talking about. Just, we want to be taught. And you figured it out. And you say, no, I'm not blind. I didn't figure anything out. I'm just not blind. And they don't understand. They say, we don't understand what you're talking about. You somehow you have great, you gain superpowers, you gain great powers, ability to do all this stuff. And you just say, no, I'm not blind, I can see. The light has come. You see, the light has shown me the unreality, that this is just a play of light upon light, the unreality of the notion that there's some separate light. There is no separate light. It's just, it's shown me. I asked it to be shown this, and it just simply showed it to me. That's all. So I'm not blind anymore. Then the blind don't understand. That's why they ask all these questions. Okay, they say, well, okay, but I want to be able to do these things. How do I do these things? I'm finding it so difficult, you know. Now how about this? Say, okay, you did this. How did you go then from here to here? And they try to break it down, quantify it, and then trying to figure out exactly, you know, they think if they make it minute enough steps, they're going to figure out how to function like you're functioning. Of course, you're seeing, you know, you have perfect sight, and they have their eyes completely shut, and yet they still think that they're going to be able to function just the same as you. But they just spend long enough time crunching on computers and numbers and systems and studying all this kind of stuff, that they're going to get the knowledge of how to be free and happy like you seem to be, you know, such at ease. Absolute folly, isn't it? You just say, open your eyes, what are you talking about? Meaning, just ask the light to show you the self, that it is light, that's all. And they think we're being smart alecky. Really, they think that we're being smart, and we're not. We're absolutely not. They're just being very, expressing a severe continuity fear is what they're doing. Because really they're saying, what? You're asking me to open my eyes? Are you kidding? If I open my eyes, I'll realize none of this was true at all. It was all a fantasy. And I wouldn't know how to function. I wouldn't have an identity. I wouldn't know who I am, what to do. I'd be lost in an abyss. You'd say, you're crazy. I can't open my eyes. That's what they're really saying. They say, that'll never be possible. So, in fact, it's so impossible, I might as well just imagine I don't have any eyes to open. So, teach me how to do this. It's like someone with two hands and 10 fingers playing the piano, just, you know, like that. And someone's hearing that and says, wow, I want to do that. And say, okay. And yet they've got their hands tied behind their backs. Okay. And they say, okay, teach me how to do that. So how are you going to do that? Well, I'm going to play with my chin, you know. Yeah, but just, he says, I know, somehow you know how to do that. So teach me how to play with my chin. Okay, so they start to study all the movements of the chin. And from here to here, how can I move fast enough? But wait a minute, you're down there at the same time as up here. How can the chin be two places at once? Well, I guess I've got to arrange the keys differently, and, you know, they become obsessed with how to play with their chin. I say, just untie your hands and get the 10 fingers, and, you know, you'd be playing away. It's easy. It's easy. They say, no, you're a great guru, you're a great teacher. We know you can teach us, you know. That's what the blind say. The blind say, oh, you're such a great teacher, such a great guru. You're so learned, you're so amazing, you know. What they're really saying is, I know you can teach me. I know I don't have to open my eyes, because I know you'll be able to teach me to do what you're doing without opening my eyes. That's what they're really saying. And of course, the teacher say, what are you talking about? You know, it's just I asked for the light to show me. That it is the light, and it showed me. That's all there is to it. I'm not a great teacher. But nonsense. Jesus said, don't call me good, meaning, oh, great, good rabbi, you can teach us. No, I can't teach you anything. Just ask the light to show you that it is the light and not something else. So that is the world in a nutshell. Great teachers, no great teachers. Why could be a great teacher? What is there to teach? There's nothing to teach. The light itself will show that it is the light. There's only the light. So, does the light have to teach itself that it's the light? No. No. It can appear to be doing that, but then it's really giving the appearance that it's not the light, right? all this teaching and learning is really how we imagining that the light is not the light. The light is presenting that somehow it needs to learn. We say, well, it must be the new light because we need to learn. The old light didn't have to learn anything. But this new light, we got to learn how to do it. All this stuff. Yeah. Just imagine your piano teacher. Not even the teacher. You're just playing the piano beautifully and people say, wow, that's absolutely miraculous. How'd you do that with your chin? You know, how'd you play with your chin like that? You say, I wasn't. They say, oh, you're a smart aleck. What are you talking about? Don't fool us. We know you got some secret teachings for us. You know, secret. The world's so interested in secret teachings, isn't it? The secret doctrine. The secret stuff. What secrecy is there? No secrecy. Nothing secret. We just ask the light to do all this. There's no secret to it. We ask the light to just show us that it is the light, and it shows us. There's no secret. There's no secret teaching. There's not really teaching at all, really. Just open your eyes. You know, how can you call that teaching? Just open your eyes. Self-evidency. It's just all self-evidency, really. But the ones who think that, you know, have their eyes closed and think there's this different light, they think there's all sorts of secrets. That they just need to, in order to be happy, they just need to learn all these secret teachings, secret doctrines, all this secret buried stuff that, you know, if they just find out all this stuff, they too will be able to be, they have these superpowers. Superpowers. They want to be able to manipulate electromagnetism, be able to manipulate the light, right? Instead of realizing that it actually is the one light. You think it's a separate light, and there's all sorts of secrets to manipulating it. And they can be like super powerful and more powerful than others and have all this great freedom to fly airplanes through the sky and do all this stuff. And I think, wow, we're really advancing. This is incredible. Of course, this is all just a story the light is telling, actually. All this confusion is just a story the light is telling. We're not actually incarnated at all. Even all the confusion is a story the light is telling us because we desire it. So when we ask the light to simply show us that it is light, suddenly the confusion is gone. The confusion melts away. It's just like that. Simple as that. That's how the vision of oneness came. When I experienced it, it's just like a soft breeze. Or, you know, the softest breeze, just, oh, there it is. Oh, okay. Just as self-evident. Oh, I see it now. It's self-evident. Oh, okay. It's like just like that. Nothing happened to electromagnetism. There was no events in electromagnetism that took place. Nothing at all took place. And it's just, I just saw the self-evidency of it. Oh, self-evidency was just now apparent to me. Because I asked the light to make it so. That's all. There's no magic, no secret, no technique, nothing. It all has to do with the continuity fear entirely. Our desire, of course, to set this ridiculous charade down, which most of us have, actually. We really don't like it. Actually, nobody likes it. It's very scary. It feels like we're about ready to be destroyed. We don't like it, but we have a severe continuity fear, so the more conscious we are of this continuity fear, the more directly we can work on it, the quicker we can go, the more success we'll have. The more we stay in the mood of repentance, very humble, and turn away from all these secret doctrines, superpowers, psychic, all these powers of, you know, metaphysical, turn away from all that stuff. Just say, no. I only have a continuity problem here, that's it. Work at that level is what brings about the success. All the other stuff, you realize people, they spend their whole lives mired in that kind of stuff. They don't get enlightened. They don't get enlightened from that. Because they're taking this to be a different light. They're taking, this is it. They say this frozen light, electromagnetism, this is it. And within this, there's all these wonderful, miraculous. or they say, well, this has some overtones that I can reach, and it's just lacking the big picture. The continuity problem is our only problem. There isn't any other problem whatsoever. We're simply fearful that we'll suddenly be propelled into the clear light. That's what we're really fearful of. Very fearful of that. Now, in this dream I had recently, I experienced all the levels of light. I experienced the clear light first, and I said, it was no problem, but it was just like, wow, I won't be able to function here if I just only see and experiencing the clear light. And then to step down about, I think, 5 steps, and I said, okay, I can handle that light. I can handle that light. That's not a problem. I can still drive. I was driving, and this intense, everything, everywhere is light. It was so bright, and it got stepped down to the point where I could still drive and still function here. I could still function in this vehicle, right, with that step down light, absolutely. But of course, those who, again, have a severe continuity fear and they don't recognize it, the questions they will ask are off track. They're bothersome, actually, and just don't want to entertain those questions. How do I gain superpowers? How do I gain special powers? How do I gain specialness? You know, I need this specialness. How do I... That's nothing to do with it. So, of course, we're thinking, we don't want to spend our lifetime, you know, wasting time with those types of questions. Absolutely not. So, we may not have a lot of those who are, you know, inquiring along these lines. And there may not be many people in the world like that, but that's fine. That's fine. That's always the way here, isn't it? Teachers don't have many. Those who are enlightened don't have many that come to see them and really want enlightenment. Not many. But we have no needs. We have no needs. We figure, wow, there's hardly anybody who's interested. How can I be helpful, successful? How can I live here, etc.? Well, when the light, we ask the light to reveal itself to us as the light, then the light takes care of all our needs here, because we realize it is only the light. The light doesn't have any real needs. So it seems your whole life is it then becomes completely miraculous and everything is just taken care of. So it doesn't matter if one comes to you, two, three, whoever, who you're actually interested and actually have, you know, pertinent inquiry, like say, or just want to evaporate their continuity fear. Let's say, I just really want to evaporate my continuity fear. So I'm just sitting here quietly and going along that way. But there will be some, you would imagine. If there's none, it's still okay. Needs will be met. Of course, as long as we're trying to develop superpowers, it seems like our needs aren't being met, because we want to develop superpowers in order to meet our needs. So we say, no, those needs must remain until I find a way to meet those needs. Whereas if we surrender the light, we're saying, no, light will meet those needs, because they're all fantasy needs. Light doesn't really have any needs at all. And since I asked light to reveal itself to me as light, that means it'll also melt away the needs. It will reveal that those needs too are just light. So your life becomes like miraculous, seemingly to others, totally miraculous. They can't figure out. So what kind of superpowers do you have? It's amazing. I don't have any, you know. I don't have any. I don't need any. The light will take care of whatever it takes care of. It's part of the play, part of the dance. It's part of a bigger picture. Anyone accepts enlightenment, requests enlightenment, then this is part of a bigger play, that how it helps out others who decide, yeah, I can do this too. It multiplies and reverberates in endless ramifications that we aren't even aware of, really. It doesn't matter. So it ends up being helpful. Ramana Maharshi, I had that dream, he came to me and said, don't give up, you know, you'll eventually get it, and when you do, it will be very helpful. But you don't realize that now. So, but I'm just telling you, I'm seeing it. So just trust in that. And I said, okay. I had faith because I could tell he was worthy of faith, because he was the light. He was his countenance. It was just, you could tell that this was the light. This was the true light. And there's only one light. This was the one light. Knowing that it is the one light, it with a, you know, had a body form, but I could tell that there was something. It wasn't like a normal human or whatever. It was just this beautiful, knowing light, knowing that it's light, and saying, "Don't give up. The way you're going about it is different than the traditional 'I am, who am I? I am,' you know, the Vedanta of India. You know, it's different." He says it's just as good, just as valid. Okay, we're not trying to say you have to do it this way or that way. It's just as valid, and eventually it will be very helpful. It will help many. He says it'll be a tremendous help. Just stick with it. So I mean, I have no evidence of that, really. I cannot get a sense of how it's going to help hardly anybody, actually. I can see these videos are helping a little bit here and there. And I know that sometimes the videos are reassuring. I can tell for sure. Because I realize, oh, this is for sure reassuring to some of those out there. Because some are able to look at this. They'll be able to look at it and say, wow. Entertain these, you know, ideas. Entertain and say, huh, that's really great. I like that. And also we get stuck and we think, oh my gosh, it's so terrible, everything's so awful. And then you say, wait a minute, but this is just light doing what we told it to do. Oh, oh wow, yeah, that's right. Now I remember. and it gives relief. So it does, you know, it does give relief. There are some very bright people in the world. There are some very bright ones in the world who are tired of this, all this stuff, and they're working to set it down. So it is helpful. And who knows how it, you know, I'll just take Ramana Maharshi at his word. He said this is going to be really, really helpful. So sure, I guess so in some way, but I don't know. I may never see it. Yeah, at least it doesn't look that way to me. Eventually, maybe I'll be able to recognize it somehow. Again, but it doesn't seem like, you know, during the life of anyone, it doesn't seem like what they do, you know, really has that much help. But look at like Srinivasagadatta Maharaj, just this guy in a little second story flat, you know, in a little Grant Road area, Grant Place, whatever, in Mumbai, as they call it. I was looking at some pictures of his house and videos and stuff, and oh my gosh, you know, it's just this busy, noisy street, honk, 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 oh gosh. Public bathroom across the street. This is so mundane and so prosaic, and it just so nondescript. Everything, and just like wow. And the people there don't even know who live there right now. I mean, there's me, you know. It's just like, and I guess if you ask people, and they laugh, crazy foreigners. You know, nobody gives a hoot about that. This realized being was there. So, you know, if you looked at that, you think nothing happened. You know, but somehow that has all trickled down in various ways where it's actually being helpful in many different ways. Not that my way is the classic Vedantin way of I am all stuff. It's not. It's very different, actually. But we're talking about very similar, you know, similarity, and certainly there's lots of pointers that I get that are helpful. Not everything is as helpful as other things, but you know, so there's a lot of these teachers, I get a lot of help, a lot of pointers, it trickles down somehow, and some, you know, generations removed, there's someone who's really picking up on this and amplifying it, you know, and really getting it, and it somehow works. But who would, you know, could ever possibly, you know, surmise that from looking at the house and where it all took place? And you say, well, how could anything take place there? It's ridiculous. How could anything? The people walking by the street is just the same old thing, right? This play of light, pretending not to be light. Full blast, right there. So of course, light is not going to stop the play because we don't desire it. So the play continues full blast, just like it always has been. Utter separation. It appears the total separation. The light is not the light. This is something different. And here was someone just sitting in a little room, knowing that this was all just a silly little play. Someone that was enlightened, you see. And it got spread out throughout the world and it's making a difference, actually. It's making a difference. And who knows? Maybe there are those in the future that are, quote unquote, future, that are enlightened, and that's reverberating back here, so to speak, in this play. Because time is an illusion. So I keep chatting, trusting in what Ramana Maharshi said. You know, don't give up. Don't give up. Keep at it. You're going to get it. And it's going to be helpful, actually. But from my standpoint, I cannot fathom how it could be helpful. It is so different, you know. It's different than the I am, the way like Nisargadatta Maharaj teaches. This is very different, actually. Just ask the light to reveal that it is the light. That is very simple. Nothing we need to do at all. Totally self-evident. But I'm sure if I were to say that to any of these teachers, they would understand implicitly. Say, of course, yes. It's just that various teachings develop the way they develop because of the people who come want answers and the way that they, where they're at with their continuity fears, etc. They require a certain set of answers. So it's not like the teacher is dumb or something. No. The teacher knows the truth, but the way that the answers are given out depends upon the amount of continuity fear that is present in the one that is they're giving the answer to. So if you got the ones with severe continuity fear, you're going to say something. I mean, Sri Anandamaya Ma said stuff that he'd say seemed to all conflict. He'd say, what? She says, I give a different answer to everyone. What do you mean? That's why her answer, she asked people not to confide what she told them when they have a meeting with her, because how she answers something to one person will be different than how she answers someone else. And the people that compare answers, they'll say, wait a minute, you know, this is all conflicting. What's going on? Because she answered at the level of the continuity fear that each person was at and gave them the answer that would help them keep the momentum going. So teachers are not generally so concerned about absolute answers, but they're more concerned about keeping the momentum going, at least, you know, some of them. I don't know how it is for all of them, but so what you hear the teacher saying, I mean, it trickles down, you know, may have been something they responded to some person at some place, and it was written down, and you think, okay, that's their teaching. No, not necessarily at all. That's not their absolute teaching. Their teaching to you might be very different. Because it all depends on how intense the continuity fear is, how to keep the momentum going so eventually it melts. It's a melting process. It's an evaporation process. And that has to keep going. The momentum has to keep going. So she was very big on spiritual practice, okay? Her whole thing was get the momentum going and keep it going by any and all means possible. The ends justify the means in some way. In other words, you know, if you need to use music, sing, whatever you need where you're at, do that and keep increasing your practice and make sure it's steady every day. You work at it more and more and more and more. That keeps the melting process going of a continuity fear. And as you go along, the self-evidency of the whole thing becomes clearer and clearer and clearer. So you say, oh yeah, now I see it. Back then I didn't see it this clearly at all. So I had a different take on it, but now I see it's much more self-evident. Oh, it's easy, oh, I see. Whereas before I didn't see it. So the heavyweight teachers, in some ways they don't seem like teachers to us because they don't give a set answer to anything necessarily, really. They're only pushing the momentum of whoever comes to them. They say, okay, where are you at? What can you do where you're at to increase your momentum? And then they give them that, you know, give them that push. Give them that push. It's very much custom sort of thing. Very customized. Those are the real heavyweight teachers. To them, it's entirely customized. They're not worried about any particular teaching. Whatever it is that can help push the momentum forward, they will do that. Knowing that this is what has to happen, that you cannot pull yourself up by the bootstraps. The continuity fear is so severe, you literally have to go through this melting process to melt away the fear gradually. It's a gradual thing. Now, there may be those who specialize in pushing a certain area, pushing it fast, okay? That may be, sure. That's very possible. That too. Others have more of a custom approach to everybody. And so others just say, no, this is what I'm doing, and I'm going to make a big push for just those who are ready for it. Make this big push. That's fine too, absolutely. There's just a massive variety of possibilities, actually. Almost, you'd say, almost endless, really. Of variable, possible variables. So it's only important that you keep your momentum going, your own momentum going. Don't worry about others' momentum, because you won't be this great custom teacher until you yourself have been totally reassured that the light is the light. And once the reassurance has gone into the clear light and all the way, then you will be the super heavyweight teacher. Sometimes the clear light sends a teacher into this world. Like Sri Ananda Mahima was, the clear light being sent into this world was able to everything was custom, effortlessly custom. She could deal with just multitasking to an extreme extent, giving custom teaching to everybody that came to her. It was all custom, even though it seemed like it was just all happening as a group sort of thing. There was this custom relating going on constantly of inspiring, you know, your own path, your own practice. What can you do to increase? That only comes from the clear light appearing in this world. So we don't need to worry about that. We don't need to think that we have to be, you know, the super adept, everything completely custom. Some customization may arise in us or something. Well, fine, but it's not really a goal. We should see it as trying to push, make this push here, right now at this time, make this push to ask the light to present itself as the light to us. That's it. Because we need to make this big push. Not a lot are going to get this right now, but some will. Okay, some will. And that's enough to produce tremendous momentum for others, actually. Tremendous momentum. Okay. Because it will plant the seed of others who seem to be falling into this next act of this play of light. And they'll say, hey, you know, interesting. So what's going on here, really? Not quite sure. This next play of the light. Wow, you know, it's just like, huh. And that changes the whole thing. It actually changes the whole situation. Because in order, changes the whole situation. It's hard to push into a new cycle of this play, a new act of this play, because we really don't want to. It takes a tremendous amount of desire and intense certitude, like, for sure I'm going to get it. For sure I'm going to get the secrets I'm looking for, the superpowers I'm looking for. And if you take the edge of intensity off of that, just a little bit, then you really step back from the edge. Once you realize you're on the edge of this new chapter and you really don't want to, all you have to take is like one or two steps back. And then the whole lens, this whole thing, realization, oh my God, okay, there's this edge. I don't want to go off that edge. You know, you stop being transfixed. If you stand on the edge of a cliff, it tends to transfix you. Whereas if you just take two steps back, you suddenly come to yourself and say, what am I doing? You know, I was ready to fall off this cliff. You know, I've done this, I've been there. You think, I mean, I was literally playing with the idea of falling off this cliff, but now I've taken two steps back and suddenly that's evaporated. Just boom, like that. And you say, whoa, I think I want to get, you know, far away from this cliff. So is only a little, you know, a little bit of witnessing in this world. It goes a long way, actually. Just enough to take a couple steps back and say, whoa, wait a minute. Do I really want to keep viewing this movie the way that it's going? Is this really a movie I want to view? Not really, no. Okay, then you say, okay. And then you go into a lesser cycle. You don't go into a greater cycle. You go into a lesser cycle. See, we don't have to step into a great cycle of delay. We can step into a lesser cycle, actually, many of this world. Some can be freed of cycles altogether. Not a lot, to tell you the truth right now. Not a lot, but some. And that's enough maybe for the rest to step back and say, whoa, wait a minute. Let's not go in this greater cycle. Let's go on this lesser cycle here. Okay, let's do that instead. The light will say, sure. Like whatever you want. It's like that. If you want the greater cycle, you'll get it. But nah, you really don't want that. It presents such a heavy drama, and you have to buy into it so heavily, you know, it just, wow, no way. You know, most of us, I believe, will say no way to that lesser cycle. But there are some here promoting this heavy cycle for us, knowing that they may be easier to control us by doing that, you know, because when you're feeling that you need to go in this heavy cycle, it's either easy then to feel like, well, there's a way to look at it. Is those who think they have developed the superpowers and all this technology and stuff, they want to show how great it is by controlling others, to sort of say, look, you see, I can. This is a different light. It's a controlling. It's this light controls. The purpose is to control. That's how happiness comes. So they want to control others. So what they're doing is they're painting they're painting this picture of this very heavy cycle, and people are looking at this saying, oh my gosh, and they're feeling so dulled down, etc. They're much easier to control at that point. There's something like that going on in the world. That's why all these movies are just, you know, these terribly frightening, morbid, heavy, fearful, monster movies, you know, just people just feel like crushed by it. Oh, here's this Godzilla coming, you know, just, oh my God, what are we gonna do? Oh, technology comes to save us. Oh my gosh, we need to worship the technology. And of course, those who have this technology, they feel that the purpose is for them is to try to even get worshipped, you know. That's how they find happiness, is to try to control everybody so everybody does what they want them to do. And that's how they feel that they're going to be happy and fulfilled in this so-called separate reality. Whereas if people step back from this heaviness and say, whoa, wait a minute, I don't really want that. Ah, the spell is broken. Then they look at these tech people and say, I'm not interested in you controlling me. What are you talking about? It's ridiculous. I'm going to take the spiritual path. I don't want to spend a long cycle of you know, being controlled like this, or maybe even a short cycle, but it takes the edge off of it, okay, and you can step back. I tell people, don't watch television, don't watch movies, absolutely not, no, don't even get in the habit of watching movies. And I know that people promote all these helpful movies, you know, no, don't watch movies at all. For instance, you're not in control of them, right? And in this video, you can stop, these videos, you can stop, you can go back to it. It's a different feeling here. De-emphasis on physicality. You know, there's a lot of things that are de-emphasized here. movies, you get used to watching them. It's easy to say, hey, why don't I watch this one too? And why don't I watch this one? Before you know it, you're watching more and more drama, more and more heaviness, more and more subliminals, more and more placement of products, more and more physicality, sensuality, fear, more and more drama, more, and it pulls you in. So I don't watch any movies. Don't watch any movies. If you can, don't watch any TV. I watch a little baseball. I watch a little bit. I watch a few innings here and there. I watch a little golf. And that's about it. That's it. I'll check out like the U.S. Open Masters. Maybe I'll watch a round, half a round, several holes. Yeah, just for a few moments and whatever, and hang out for just a little while. But again, don't get into the habit of that. Stay away from it as much as possible. Especially stay away from movies, I would say. I don't care if somebody says that this movie will enlighten you. It's got all this great information. No, stay away from it. Stay away. Holy Spirit told me that. Don't watch movies. It had me watch movies like 6 movies a day. I was watching movies like 12 hours a day for like, couple years almost? A year and a half? Long time. I watched so many movies. And then I said, okay, are you ready to, is that enough? I said, I've had enough. I'm not interested in watching any more movies. That's it. I'm not interested in movies anymore. And the Holy Spirit says, good. And from that day, I've never watched another movie. And how long has that been? 20 years or something? And I don't think I've watched a movie in 20 years. Got no interest in it. And the Holy Spirit said, it's necessary. Because this was before all this high-tech stuff came in, right? Wizardry. And the Holy Spirit knew it was coming. And if I hadn't overcome my fascination with movies by that time, I would be pulled into it. So I said, here, check out what movies. And I realized, this is not it. Movies are not it. No way. No way. And now all these movies that have come in the last 20 years, and no interest in them. Didn't watch them. Same with television. I said, stop watching. Gotta stop watching. He said, if you don't stop watching, you're going to fail in what you came here to do, for sure. And I said, okay, I gotta stop watching. Stop watching. Very wise decision, for sure. Music, radio, same thing. Stop listening to radio. Don't need it. Stop looking at magazines. Stop. Stop reading books. Stop. So all this stuff gradually, you give it up, but I just did a whole bunch of this, like reading books so much, and then eventually I got to the point where I said, that's not it. I can give that up. It's not a problem. Not a problem. It's not the answer. See, none of this stuff, movies, books, or whatever you do, it's not the answer. The answer is to simply ask light to reveal itself to you, that it is light. That's all. That's the answer. It's light itself that's the answer. Not a book, not even a guru, not even a teacher, not even any person, place, thing, concept, idea, belief. None of that is the answer. It's the light itself is the answer. And the willingness to simply ask the light to show me that reveal to me that you are, that the light is the light. The light is light. That's all. Light is light. Not something else that it's been appearing to be to us. And you get this by realizing that we're the ones that requested that light fool us, deceive us, appear to be not light. We asked light to do that. Light did not do it on its own. Okay, this is very, very, absolutely, totally all important. Light did not do this on its own initiative. We, Spirit, asked the light. It was our desire to have this experience. And of course, light responded to our desires as it always does. Light does not take the initiative. It does not take the initiative. This is all important because those who are deceived in this confusion believe that light is the one that took the initiative. They think that God did it. God's done all this. No, God had nothing to do with any of this. We, Spirit asked. Spirit asked light to do all this. God did not ask light, hey light, I want you to to appear as if you're not light, to deceive me, to deceive this deceived spirit. No way, no way. So we're the ones responsible. Therefore, we're the ones who can ask light to show us that light is light. We don't have to pray to God and say, God, light is appearing not to be light, and you asked it to do so, and you're causing us so much suffering. Can you please change your mind about light so I can be happy? That doesn't work. That doesn't work. God doesn't respond to that. God will just tell you, Holy Spirit, say, listen to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will say, no, God did not is not responsible for light pretending not to be light. Spirit is responsible. Spirit, the Son of God, Spirit is the one who said, you know, I want to play like I'm God. So light, I want you to pretend that you're not light, so I can feel that believe there's some separate kingdom that I have created, and that I'm now ruling over and living in, and you know, it's me. I'm all of this new kingdom. We're the ones that did it. So of course we're the ones who can say, hey light, I'm not interested in this silly play anymore. Can you please show me that you are the light? The light is light. Just reassure me. Can you please reassure me and show me that light is light? And then light will respond to that. All important that we don't blame God for any of this. All important. We don't blame the light for any of this. If you can get this, then for sure, you're right there. You're right there. Success is, you know, within reach. Is within reach. Because that's the huge hurdle to get over. Because those who desire a separate kingdom, of course, they're going to insist that this is all mandated by the highest authority, right? That this light not being light is everything's the way it is, irreversibly, irrevocably, because the highest authority is the one that is responsible for this. So that keeps their desire, keeps their interest in this play of light, believing that it's a separate kingdom. It keeps it there. So of course they're going to insist that God's responsible, or they will insist that nobody's responsible. It just arose for no reason. Light just decided to do it for no reason whatsoever. It just decided on its own to do this. You know, this all just arose from nowhere. You know, that nonsense. Then you can't do anything about it either, can you? Oh well, gotta make the most of it. So we're just getting to the utter simplicity of just simply requesting from light itself, not from what we think is this different light, not from some electromagnetic process or something. We're just requesting directly from the light itself. Light, show me that you are light. Show me that the light is light and only light, that there's only one light. Show me that this has all been a play of the one light. Reassure me this has all been the play of the one light. So just pray directly to the light. Just ask directly of the light. Ask and you shall receive. Knock at the door. It will open. So I may wrap this up now, but I may make another video. My cat is just holding on so miraculously to life somehow. So I got to honor this cat, this fantastic presence of a really bliss. I'm going to keep on, you know, working as hard as I possibly can here. It's very important. And when someone says, hey, I'm hanging in there, I want you to, you know, maybe the cat says, come on, I want you to get it. I'm hanging in here. You know, I'm working as hard as I can to stick around. So you know, Work as hard as you can to, you know, invoke the light, ask the light. We don't need to invoke the light. That's all magic. Forget about magic. We're simply humbly in all mood of repentance, just saying, light to simply reassure me, light, that I just all I'm asking is to be shown that the light is the light. That's all. I'm not asking you to do anything with the light. I'm not invoking the light to do something. I invoke the light to go over there and smash the darkness. None of that, no. Only light reveal that you are the light, that all this is just the light. All this is your play. Simply reassure me that all this has simply been your play as per my request. That's all that I request. Nothing more than that. Very simple. Nothing more than that. This is why humility and Buddha repentance leads to success, whereas all this other stuff doesn't. We're not trying to be superheroes invoking the light to do something. The only thing we're after is reassurance, nothing else. Just reassure me that light is light. Light is light. Light is light. That's all. Just reassure me that light is light. It's that simple. Light is light. Because we've been believing, seeing this play, that light isn't light. So all we need to be reassured is light is light. Light is light. That's it. All right. Very great. I'll wrap this video up now.